evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome. My name is Asif Larji. Amchi Mumbai, maximum city, Bombay Mary John, the gateway to India, India's gateway to the world. However you choose to refer to our city, we all agree that this city is like none other. A unique melting pot of cultures, religions, sights, sounds, fragrances, and tastes. At Avid Learning, we are fascinated by the wealth of experiences, happenings, encounters the city has to offer, and the many avatars, histories, and perspectives it includes. Began in 2012, this series, Multipolis Mumbai, we'd like to think was a tryst with the city. The series has explored the city's rich past and looked at new horizons whilst tracing the journey how colonial Bombay has become the Amchi Mumbai of today. We facilitated over 41 curated discussions and programs in formats like workshops, panel discussions, walkthroughs, a retrospective at the Kalagar Arts Festival, a series at the CSMVS in 2016. And in fact, this series began, I'm just going to give you a little anecdote, and I can't see Naresh at the moment. Where is he, guys? This all series began in 2012. I've just come back to India, and Bombay was Mumbai at that point, and I was sitting with Naresh Fernandes and Raju Thakkar at the bagel shop in Bandra, and we decided we have to do something about Bombay, and that was the birth of Multipolis Mumbai. Naresh anchored the first 9 episodes in 2012, and so today he's back after 32 episodes to take his job again, better late than never. I would like to say welcome back, Naresh, but he's not here at the moment. Anyway, moving along. For our second iteration that began in 2017, we've explored the city through businesses, brands, philanthropy, art, illustration, poetry, design, to name a few. Continuing on this dialogue with the city, today on the occasion of India's 73rd Independence Day, we seek to uncover the fascinating aspects of pre- and post-independence Mumbai and examine the city's role in and the influence on India's freedom movement. The National Gallery of Modern Art Mumbai, the Ministry of Culture, Government of India and Avid Learning present Multipolis Mumbai, Independence and Our City. And he's again left us. Wow. A panel discussion that will revisit the city from the historic era when Mumbai was Bombay and poised at the brink of political, patriotic, and socio-cultural renaissance with the birth of a brand new nation. This program is a continuation of Avid's collaboration with the NGMA, and I'd like to thank Mrs. Anita Rupavataram and her team for giving us this opportunity again. It gives me great pleasure to welcome on stage my historian, Murali Ranganathan, corporate archivist and founder of Past Fair Perfect Heritage Management, Sanghamitra Chatterjee, film scholar, theorist, and former curator at the National Museum of Indian Cinema, Amrit Gangar, architect and urbanist, Himanshu Burte, and moderator for the evening, journalist and editor of scroll.in, Naresh Fernandes. For more about each of our panelists, please refer to the bios that have been handed out to you. And remember, take these out, put them on silent, and start using them. Get social. Our handle is @AvidLearning, and hashtag is LearningNeverStops. Thank you. Over to you, Naresh, and looking forward to a fascinating discussion.
Good evening and welcome. This is always a funny room to talk to because half the people are there and half the people on the other side. We're sort of, it's a room divided, and like somebody pointed out, I think Murali, it's a sort of Himanshu, sort of reflects the state of the nation at this moment. But happy Independence Day in advance. The spirit of freedom is embedded in the very DNA of our city, and that becomes apparent as you walk down the streets of Mumbai. In Marinelands, there's a theater called Liberty. One of the most prominent landmarks in Kemp's Corner used to be a school called New Era. Opposite VT, you'll find a large open stretch called Azad Maidan. Around the world, of course, cities are associated with freedom. For many who migrated from the stifling confines of the village, cities offer the opportunity to find individual autonomy, to break the shackles of parochial bonds, to experience the shock of the new. But some cities are closely associated with the quest for political freedom, and Bombay, though we sometimes tend to forget to, is among them. Our city is, after all, where the stirrings of the Indian National Movement were first felt when the Indian National Congress held its first meeting at Gwalior Tank in 1885. Though my friends from across the Ghats always tell me this is just an accident of history, that it was actually supposed to be held in Pune, but they had a cholera epidemic, I think, and so it was moved hastily to Bombay. But what the heck, that's an honor we can claim. Many of the important leaders of the freedom struggle were closely associated with the city. Dadabhai Nawaji, Tilak, Gandhi, Vallabhai Patel, Dr. Ambedkar among them. And the names of many of our streets resonate with their memories. Our streets also bear the names of freedom fighters who weren't quite so prominent. Baba Genu, for instance, a mill worker who was crushed to death in Kalwa Devi in 1930. As he tried to stop a truck carrying foreign cloth. As I was thinking about today's event, it occurred to me that Bombay also played a vital role in another struggle for political freedom that played out for more than a decade after 1947, the movement for Goa liberation. Until Goa was integrated into the Indian Union in 1961, Bombay was the base for such stalwarts as P.D. Cunha and Aloysius Suarez, who pushed hard for the Portuguese to leave. Rallies and dharnas were held here. This is where freedom fighters escaping the Portuguese took refuge. And this is where funds were raised. The historic building in which we are sitting today has a link with another freedom struggle even further away. From the time this building, the Kawasji Jahangir Hall, was completed in 1911, it served as one of the city's premier venues for concerts and for public events. And so on February the 21st, 1936, Reverend Howard Thurman, the leader of the first African-American delegation to visit India, stood up in this venue, I think downstairs, this didn't exist, to talk about the struggles of his people. One of the main reasons his delegation was in India was to discuss and see how Gandhi's ideas of satyagraha and civil disobedience could be used by African Americans in their fight for equality. That meeting with Gandhi would happen shortly after and in Surat, but before that Thurman and his compatriots had several meetings with a range of Bombay residents. So far, I think there have been two books about Gandhi and Bombay. But as far as I know, there hasn't been a book about Bombay and the freedom struggle. And that's because I think our city's contributions to the independence movement are too vast to be included within the covers of a single book. And that's the challenge we sort of face this evening as a very knowledgeable panel takes us through several aspects of Bombay's association with the freedom struggle. We can't in any way be complete, because that's impossible, but they'll offer us perhaps glimpses of a history that we've forgotten about. And so to begin with, I'm going to ask Murali Ranganathan, who knows all about the 19th century, to tell us about the freedom struggle before the freedom struggle.
Thanks, Naresh. Just to sort of respond to your point about has there been any book on Bombay and the freedom struggle, or rather freedom struggle in Bombay, there is one book which sort of passes muster under that rubric, which is basically the Gazetteer series has one on just the Bombay and freedom struggle. It's not a narrative, but it contains a lot of material on the freedom struggle. So that's the closest talks about Bombay and the freedom struggle. About 3 years back, I was editing a book, which is basically a collection of articles by the now late Professor J.V. Nayak, who unfortunately passed away just last month. And he had done a lot of work sort of excavating some of the early material related to the subject which we have, which is basically, when did Indians realize that they have been subjugated? And when did they start voicing their opinions? So when I started looking at those articles, I went back to the archives and started looking at all the early newspapers which were published in the 1830s, the 40s and the 50s, and started trying to find out when was the first time, or at least in the archives, because almost nothing has survived. So how far back can we trace this idea about what Nauroji later sort of framed as the grain theory? And I went back to the archive, and you see that until the 1920s, so until 1830, there were hardly any Indian newspapers. You of course had the immortal Bombay Samachar, which started in 1822, but for some reason, I don't think for the last 50 years anybody has been able to see the early issues. So we don't know what were the opinions of the editor of the Samachar and the people who wrote in that newspaper. But starting from the early 1830s, when the Earl of Clare, an Irishman, became the governor of Bombay, he was the first person to in the list of governors who sort of was imported from the United Kingdom, as opposed to growing from the hierarchy. So he had different views about governance, and one of them was that he let you say anything in the papers. And unlike the previous governors who had tighter control. So by the early 1830s, the newspapers are full of candid opinions. And you had Indians starting newspapers in English, Marathi, Gujarati, Urdu, Persian, and Portuguese too, in Bombay. All of this in Bombay. I'm just talking only about Bombay since that's our geography today. So the first English newspaper to be started by an Indian was called the Bombay Native Observer from 1832. It was edited by an Indian, it was owned by an Indian, but printed by an European, perhaps an Englishman, who sort of had the wherewithal to print the newspaper. And that paper is a revelation. It talks about all kinds of things concerned with Indians. But by early 1833, the editor was quite candid about what impact the British rule had been having in India. As all of you know, the Bombay Presidency was really expanded only in 1818 when the British took over from the Peshwas. And by 1833, when the charter of the East India Company was up for renewal, and that's when a little lobbying started both in the UK as well as here about monopolies and so on, and that's when people could start airing the views about the government of the East India Company. And if you'll permit me, I would like to read a couple of extracts. Is that okay? This is the extract, the first one, which is from 4th July 1833. So you can imagine it's almost 200 years ago. The period is now arrived when every native of India who wishes well to his country should exert his capacity in promoting every scheme that has either an instant or remote tendency to contribute to her welfare and prosperity. Whoever is not blind to the condition of the natives or his own importance will confess that the present system of government in India requires not a partial or a modified alteration, but a total, thorough-paced and vigorous system of renovation, that it should be made to pass from exclusion to liberty, from monopoly to competition, from despotism to freedom, that where it has implanted sorrow, misery and aversion, it should spirit up affection and gratitude, that a reconciliation of interest should be effected and blended with consistent and suitable advantages to both native and European. In fine, so molded and proportioned to the fairest symmetry of justice and integrity as to meet the approbation and ensure the esteem of all on whom it operates. So you can see that this is what I have discovered as the earliest expression of political ideas in India. Maybe something happened in Calcutta, but I haven't come across that. But in Bombay, this is the first time somebody could actually really call for a total change in the way of way India was being governed. And he also talks about the economic issues, and he's got this phrase which mimics the brain theory. The grain theory of Nauroji. He says this: no doubt, European men and women may be very liberal, and so they ought. Their hands are in our pockets. And if the levers as much as allows our existence to hang together, we are to be happy and content. And so we are. Hands in our pockets. I mean, what else could describe the colonialism for the next 150 years? I mean, that's the phrase which sort of stands out. And I think it looks much more attractive than brain theory, certainly. You will agree. So this is what a very young editor from 1833 had to say about the British rule in India. And immediately after this issue was published in 11 July 1833, the newspaper folded up. So I think there was a limit to the tolerance which even the new governor had. So I couldn't find out any actual diktat saying that wind up or something, but there are no more issues after this, and there is an obituary in another newspaper which said that the editor spoke rather too frankly. So clearly this was where what they could take, but no more. So there you are. And it goes on and on. And so by 1840, I think there were enough people in Bombay who could realize what was happening. Naresh, stop me even if I'm going for too long. Am I going for too long already?
Yeah, I think we should sort of jump ahead to 1857.
All right. I will jump ahead to 1857. All right. But I would like to read one little thing. Since we are sitting in a Parsi-funded institution, I would like to quote one Parsi. Jamshedji Ji boy. I mean, the one person who's been still immortal. I mean, everybody says JJ all the time. Maybe they know it's Jamshedji Ji boy. So he's still very much in the part of the city. So here's what he says about the British government. It will be difficult for the British government to remove a very unfavorable impression from the minds of the native community as to the manner in which their just claims to indemnity have been disregarded and made to give way to other objects more convenient to be attended to in England and more adapted to the interests of persons living within the limits of the United Kingdom than to meet the consideration of what is justly due to those who reside in the more distant parts of the empire. I mean, here was a man who had just got a knighthood, the first Indian person in 1842 to become a knight. I mean, he got that medal from dispatched by Queen Victoria. And in his private letters, which are still preserved in Bombay, in the University of Mumbai, all kinds of things sort of tumble out. He's critical of the tax policy, he's critical of the annexation policy, and he's writing to members of parliament in Westminster, asking them to lobby for India. So here you have a man who sort of represents British interests, who sort of identified himself with the British government, but is quite clear about what the impact of their policies are to the common man in India. And there are a few more instances, but as Naresh instructs, I sort of jump to 1857. 1857, as you know, was a defining year for India. It wasn't that much of a defining year for people in Western India. There wasn't much happening here. The Qazi of Pune city was arrested about the same time when the mutiny sort of flared up in the northern parts of India. And that was the first indication that there is some sort of, that the chapati messaging was happening even in the Bombay presidency too. So he was promptly arrested and nothing happened for 3-4 months. And in the meanwhile, I'm sure all of you heard of Mangal Pandey. But have you heard of Mangal Gadariya? Mangal Gadariya. Mangal Gadariya was one of two people who were shot off from the mouth of a cannon in the Maidan here, just Esplanade, or what do you call the Azad and the Cross Maidan. He was one of two. The other was Drill Sergeant Sayyid Hassan. Both of them were shot off the mouths of a cannon, two cannons presumably, and that was sort of a salutary warning to the rest of the army in Bombay that this is the fate you will meet if you are even suspected of having conspired to rebel against the British government in Western India. So that was the sort of a kind of a terror inducing incident which happened, and that was not the end of it all. There were many other people who were investigated. Even the high and mighty in Bombay, like Jagannath Shankar Sheikh, whose statues you see everywhere, was suspected of, I mean, he was obviously in communication with all the princes of Marathi speaking princes, at least of India, because they were all royalty. He was also royalty in Bombay, and they would have been in communication for many years before that, and that sort of led to a suspicion that perhaps he knew what's happening. And but anyway, he was exonerated pretty soon. So there were articles in the newspapers which said that that there are the people in Bombay are conspiring. But very soon the rumors were quelled. There were a few executions, but nothing beyond that happened in Bombay. And Govind Narayan, who sort of was the chronicler, self-appointed chronicler of Bombay at the time, described the situation where there were prayers being held in all the religious institutions, all religions, for the victory of the British in the mutiny, and presumably their prayers were answered.
Who was the police officer at that time?
So you had this Charles Forget, who was half Indian, half British, half Irish, I don't know.
Whose name is still on the street.
Yeah, still on the street, Forget Road. So you had this police commissioner who could sort of, you know, who could sort of wear any kind of identity. He could adopt any identity, prowl the streets and personally listen to conversations, understand what. He was also multilingual. He could understand Marathi, Gujarati, Urdu, the three languages of Bombay, and understand what's happening. And he is the person who's credited with sort of having quelled the mutiny in Bombay. And Naresh, if I can just...
So they were afraid of what they called Wahhabi phobia.
That was a totally parallel thing. I mean, it wasn't nothing to do with mutiny, really. I mean, that was Wahhabism, which was also sort of, you know, spreading from the west to the east, but that was just happened to be coincidental. I would say, not really connected to the mutiny really. So I would also like to sort of, I mean, if you can give me 5 more minutes, do I have 5 minutes or 2 minutes?
Sure.
Maybe later on.
We'll come back.
Yeah, I think we'll come back. So just to sort of, you know, summarize what I've been saying, there was a lot of political thinking happening within Bombay in terms of what is the economic impact of British rule in the very early period. I mean, before 1857, I'm talking about the 30s, 40s and 50s, there were books written comparing Indian British rule to rule by native princes, and there were plays being organized in Bombay talking about which was better. And there's a poem which I would like to read maybe later on about what was being performed in those plays. Thanks.
Thank you, Murali. Let's sort of jump a few decades into the future. And Amrit, Gandhi has been the subject of several films, but as far as the record goes, he's known to have watched only 2 films himself, I believe. One was a pro-Soviet Hollywood film called Mission to Moscow, which we're told he didn't like. The other was a film called Ram Raja, directed by Vijay Bhatt, and he didn't watch the entire film either. But you've been doing some research on how Gandhi used films and cinema houses to great effect. Will you tell us about that, please?
I think what information you got is from Googleshwara. That's the god only.
Yes,
only god we
exactly.
Second film, of course, he saw. And in the museum, we have put one floor, Gandhi and Cinema, in the National Museum of Indian Cinema. And he's watching, actually. There's a statue of Gandhi sitting on the chair. And he's watching Ram Raja. He was 74-year-old there in Mumbai. He was living in Juhu, in Sumati Maharaj's bungalow, Pamban. You should go there. There's a small little museum there. And we go up to Juhu at least, from South Bombay to Juhu. So what I just wanted to complement or supplement what you said about this very building we are sitting in. It's historic. Its architect was George Wittet, the same architect which built Gateway of India. And also Institute of Science, this building is the extension of Institute of Science. So this is very interesting. Prince of Wales Museum was architect for John Wittet. I think John Peck was his mentor or something. So this is interesting. 1924, Gandhi addressed a meeting right here in this building. But just what you wrote in the introduction of this program, the narrative or the story of India's independence doesn't end at 1947. Nation doesn't become brand new nation in 1947. 1955, something happens in this building, because till Goa was under Portuguese, we didn't have complete India as we see it now. as independence or free. 1955, right in this building, there are three floors. This was, I think, redesigned by Romy Khosla in 1996. But before that, I used to attend the music concert here, Kalke Kalakar, Aajke Kalakar. But the three floors were jam-packed. There was Satyagraha for Goa. Mumbai has such a great contribution to Goa liberation. There was Voice of Freedom, the underground radio, which was done in Mumbai. The Livia Lobo, the lady who has written extensively about this. This building is so interesting. 1939, a convocation of SMBT University happens in this hall, where Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel and Mahatma Gandhi both were there. This is interesting. 1939, first women's university. Of course, we should credit Mercy Curve. We have the longest road here to Curve's name. Mercy Curve, who started in 1920, around 20, the whole idea about women's university, then headquarters were shifted to Mumbai, 1936. First women's university in not only India's whole of Southeast Asia happens in Mumbai. 1936, when in 1939 there was a convocation here in this very building where Gandhi and Patel were there. So this gives me a certain new thought to the image that we see here. It's Gwalior Tank, August Kranti Mendal, 1942, Quit India movement. All this process, long process, is all women. So I call this city not Money Mumbai or Movie Mumbai, it's also Mahila Mumbai. The women and Mumbai has to be studied properly. This city is built by women, as I personally feel, really seriously feel. It's women either from Malbar Hill or from BDD Chawl in Burli. They have equally contributed to the character of the city. What is the character of the city? The multipolis is a beautiful idea, which includes cosmopolis and metropolis. I have another idea about the city called ruralopolis. It's rural. Every city is rural village. I still buy a ticket for Kandivali village where I live. Delhi is made up of sarais, all villages. So this Indian cities are typically ruralopolis. This is a new term I wrote in one of my speaking three articles. So maybe this multipolis is composed of cosmopolis, metropolis and ruralopolis. Cosmopolis became dubious sometime, where parochial politicians took over. And when I am talking to about Kashmir, for example, there are parties who say that they don't allow outsiders for job there. What we are doing here? We also drive people away. You cannot have jobs, sons of the soil. So this contradiction also is absorbed by the city. The city is such fantastic. The Mumbai Devi has such a great womb, which can contain all contradictions, all stories, all narrative inside her. So this is the city which we all love. And Gandhi, when we speak about independence movement, we cannot escape Gandhi. We cannot think without Gandhi. Gandhi becomes very important because after he came back from South Africa, 1916, he holds a meeting at Opera House. He never liked cinema. He is on record. 1927, Rangacharya Committee report, which I put in the museum, he is on record that he never liked cinema from moral point of view. But he uses the cinema houses. He doesn't decline the invitations given by, and many of these organizations were women's organizations who invited him to address meetings in cinema houses. Three cinema houses were often used: Opera House, Excelsior and Empire. Excelsior was early novelty, that is not there now. But three cinema houses are often used from 1961 to 1934 on various subjects. First, the address at Opera House was Girmitia. You know, Girmitia is indentured labor. There was a protest against indentured labor, Girmitia, and Gandhi was invited to address the meeting. Then there was a meeting about Hindi Sahitya that was also very much connected to freedom movement. There was a meeting, I have a whole chapter and this Mumbai City and Independence. This is a Gujarati book I wrote, and I had this chapter called Mumbai ane Azadi ni Chalwar, Mumbai City and Freedom Movement. There is a chapter which is not very sketchy because it was a weekly column in Mumbai Samachar. Gandhiji and Mumbai's Mahila, Mumbai's Women, 1918 to 1934. Gandhiji and Mumbai's cinema houses. Then M.K. Gandhi and Kasturba, Mukam post Mumbai, 1915, when they came from South Africa. The title of Mahatma was given to him not by Rabindranath Tagore, but in Jaipur. And I have the document, they say Mahatma Gandhi, the first time he was addressed. And immediately after he came back from South, then Gandhi's travel by third class railway, which also happened right here in Mumbai, from Mumbai. And then Pamban Bungalow and Gandhi. There's a famous photograph you see on Juhu Beach, that stick, that little boy Kanu Gandhi, which is when he liked ocean. So he would sit on the chair on the seashore, Juhu, and then he was running with a stick and that boy, the little Kanu Gandhi. That's a very beautiful photograph that he had. So Pamban Bungalow, where he used to live, 2 months he lived there because he was recuperating, but he was not well. So that's how Mumbai relationship is. He, Mahadev Desai, would invite, the Pagnis, who Vishnu Pantman Pagnis, who acted in Sant Tukaram film, the very, very famous film, Prabhat Film Company, which won the Venice Film Award at that time. So he would invite Pagnis and to sing Abhang, and Gandhi would listen to him. So all this is connected. So not only Mani Bhavan is well known, but also he goes to, and then another meeting was in Excelsior, he goes to Mahalakshmi about the thing, cleanliness. So he goes to Mahalakshmi where garbage was dumped at that time. So now it's Dharavi too, but at that time, but garbage was dumped at Mahalakshmi. He goes there. He goes to the slums where Harijans lived. He goes to Varli, where Arjun's living in slums, and tells the rich people in Malabar Hill, you go there and see how they live. It's a stinking garbage dumps that they are living with. So all this happened in the city of Mumbai. This goes on till 1939 here, and then 1942. August Kranti Maidan, the Quit India Movement, extends up to 1946 as naval mutiny. One of the slogans was Quit India, 46. It was not even a week long agitation that happened, it was suppressed. But it was important because many people from mill area participated, particularly Communist Party of India participated in this naval mutiny, which is not very well recorded. There is no film. But in Subhash Bose's film Azad Hind Sena, there are references in the film of Sam Babu's film on Subhash Chandra Bose and all that. There is a film called Bhakt Vidur. Now this is an important film. Bhakt Vidur was made in 1921 in the wake of Rowlatt Act 1919, which was shown in Majestic Cinema here. British came to know Dwarka Das Sampat of Kohinoor Film Company. Kohinoor Film Company was very big at Dadar. And Dwarka Das Sampat was a Gandhian himself. He made this film, produced this film. He becomes the Vidur himself, and Homi Master becomes Duryodhan. It's a Mahabharata story. British came to know this is a film against us. It's a kind of perfidy or whatever. And they banned the film. This was the first political film banned by the British in various parts of India at that time. Karachi, Sindh, some parts of Madras, it was banned. But 1921, this film is made and Gandhi becomes, because he was donning Gandhi cap, Dwarka Das Sampat, Bhakt Vidur, many more. So this film happened here, Kohinoor Film Company produced here. There's a film called Andolan. It's extremely important film, produced by Chicago Radio Company, public address system, Herman Motwani. And the entire film was, except the outside scenes, outdoor scenes, it was produced at Bombay Talkies in Malad. So this film is becoming extremely important. The first shot is 1885 Congress session, INC session in Mumbai. 1885 Mumbai, that's the first scene that we see. Of course, that is 1951 Mumbai. But the whole film has documentary evidences, documents or documentary film produced by Ranjit Film Company, also Krishna Film Company. They were the nationalists, Sardar Chandula Shah. Ranjit studio is still there, you can see the board at the other east. But I would argue that this first, very first film of India, the Dada Saheb Phalke, Raja Harishchandra, 1913, was a nationalist film. It was called first Swadeshi film. Phalke himself said it's such Swadeshi film because it was made by Indians, for Indians, and with Indian caste and all that. It's completely Indian film. So, Pundalik, which was also made at that time, 1 year before Raja Harishchandra, is not considered to be the first Indian film, narrative film. Because his cameraman was British, from Bond and Safford company, and therefore it's not considered as first Indian film. Dada Saheb Phalke gets the credit. Both films were shown at cinematograph near Harishchandra's hospital. There was a cinema house, not exactly cinema house, but to kind of hall where they showed it, and that was 1930. What film we have in the film archive is 1970. The 1913 film was destroyed, and we have only two reels, first and the last reels. But I will consider this as a nationalist film. Produced in Mumbai at Dada, Mathura Das Makhanji's bungalow was given to Dada Saheb Phalke. I went there and saw the, nothing is there now. But that is the location on Dadar, that road is called Dada Saheb Phalke Road. So this city has so much connection with Mahatma and the movie both. What else? You have another question?
We'll come back to that.
Okay. So there are many things which I can merit with cinema houses, also film studios. There are five or six films that Kohinoor Film Company, Krishna Film Company and Ranjit Film Company made. One was Salt Satyagraha at Wadala.
Great, so let's come back to that after we
round
right. Thanks, that was fascinating. Sanghamitra, Sarojini Naidu may or may not have said that it took a lot of money to keep Gandhi in poverty. You've been doing research on some of the people who made sure that he stayed in poverty and funded the movement. Can you tell us about what you've been looking at?
Yeah, so I've basically been asked to sort of represent industry and business because I'm a corporate archivist. I do a bunch of work with old business families and business houses. Let's just understand what's happening in the business world around this time. We're obviously not talking about any large corporations. You are talking about, in terms of Indian players, you're talking about the mill owners. This becomes a large segment of the people the capitalist class, right? The corporations are largely owned or co-owned by Britishers. You have the Glaxos, you have the Lever brothers, all of them functioning around. But again, obviously, they are not participating in any kind of movement that's happening. On the other hand, you have the industrialists, or rather the mill owners, like I mentioned earlier, who aren't doing too much. Say, there's no corporate policy like we understand it today, right? Throughout this period of the freedom struggle, these companies or these mills aren't doing anything officially. So the onus of the responsibility of doing something for the freedom movement actually falls on the promoter or the promoter family. It's they who drive this. But even then, in the first few years or the decades of the freedom struggle of this century, the previous century, they aren't really that active. You have a few sporadic cases of some kind of contribution, but it's not whipped up into a frenzy as it does when Gandhi comes into the picture. Now, when Gandhi comes in, things change. Now, Gandhi speaks to Gandhi somehow has this power to reach out to a whole, a wide cross section of people. He's been able to reach out to the industrialists, at the same time he's talking to the workers, he's responding to the workers are responding to him. You also have the peasants. Gandhi is reaching out to the peasants, he's reaching out to the women. So he's talking to a whole lot of people and he's saying strange things. He's saying things like practice celibacy. He's saying things like don't let your women wear ornaments because, I mean, a lot of reasons, but they also, ornaments also give out body odor. He's saying these things to the industrialists and their wives. But at the same time, there is some kind of connect that he makes with this class of people. And what does Gandhi get out of this class of people? Like Naresh hinted, he does get money and the expertise to roll out his various plans. So he comes in 1915, 1916. In the beginning, he's not really political, but the first major political act that Gandhi, commits to comes, you know, happens sometime in the 1919, the Rowlatt Act. Somebody here mentioned the Rowlatt Act. We do see the business community, the merchant community, suddenly come together and respond to a political event. The Mulji Jetha, the merchants or the traders of the Mulji Jetha market and two other markets in Bombay strike work, close shops for an entire day. Now that's a risk that these businessmen are taking, but that has been taken by them. It's a clear statement that goes out to the administration that acts such as the Rowlatt Act will not be tolerated and their independence, their freedom will not be questioned. And all of this is happening after Gandhi has made some kind of an impact on them. So what starts out with, say, for instance, the Rowlatt Act, as the non-cooperation movement takes momentum, and which again is launched here in Bombay at a mill owner's yard. And not too many of us know of this particular gentleman, but there used to be this mill owner called Umar Sohani, and he had a yard in Parel, and that's where the first big foreign cloth bonfire happens. Now, if you look up Umar Sobhani, there's just this one line that comes up on him, but there are, unfortunately, there's more coverage on his suspicious death that happens in 1926, and which is why probably his legacy does not continue. He died so young and so soon into the movement that none of us really know about Umar Sobhani. But moving on from there, so that's where non-cooperation starts off in Bombay with this clear act of defiance. And then you have a whole lot of, a whole lot of contribution that comes in from the people of Bombay. At the same time, Gandhi also starts what is known as the Tilak Swaraj Fund in memory of Lokmanya Tilak. So this happens sometimes in around 1920, soon after Tilak passes away. But it's not just, I mean, yes, history textbooks will tell you the fund was created and, you know, all kinds of things happened. But here the issue is that the fund goes on to sort of provide for the freedom fighters and the movement and the concept and the fight that Gandhi had orchestrated. That is the key reason why the Tilak Swaraj Fund is important. And you have key people who Gandhi relies on, and some of these key people are the businessmen. So the Tilak Swaraj Fund, for instance, there were two people. Again, Umar Sobhani comes in. He and Jamnalal Bajaj are made, the officials of the Tilak Swaraj Fund. In a couple of months, Jamnalal Bajaj is made the treasurer of this fund, and he is responsible, Jamnalal Bajaj being the founder of the Bajaj group. Now, he is responsible to disburse the funds, to fundraise first, and then disburse the funds for the various non-cooperation movement activities. Now, it's not simple. They've given themselves a task of, 1 crore in 1 year. The deadline ends on June 30th, 1921. Sometime in March or April, Gandhi comes to Bombay and he addresses an audience in Ghatkopar, and he chides the people of Bombay because apparently only about, you know, some 40,000 or something has been collected by Bombay province. And he's not happy. He expected much more. And then, now this somehow hits home.
especially for the industrialists, for the businessmen in Bombay, who now started looking at Gandhi as their spiritual leader. Now, their association with the freedom struggle was never with the Congress. The Congress was too intellectual, was too distant. It was always Gandhi. And this kind of statement, the kind of statement that he makes in Ghatkopar, kind of hits home. And then you suddenly see this mass mobilization of industrialists, of mill owners, businessmen in Bombay. And by June 15th, 2 weeks before the last day of the fund, Bombay has collected 36 lakhs. And that's one of the, 36 lakhs, yeah, I think Bombay tops it. All other states fall much behind. Now, you have various people. Now, you have the Godrejes. You have Ardeshir Godrej, the founder of the Godrej Group that contributes about a lakh to this particular fund. You have Jamnalal Bajaj obviously contributing a lakh that goes into just funding lawyers and doctors. You know, that group that decided to stay away from administration jobs that back then in 1920-21 had given up its jobs. So this particular fund goes only to help these lawyers out. But still, by 30th June, the fund is 2 lakhs short. And you again have people like Umar Subhani and Jamnalal Bajaj put in an additional 1 lakh so that Gandhi meets his 1 crore target. Thereafter, of course, the business community, these leaders who are now becoming influencers, are given the sole responsibility of dispersing the funds, who needs what kind of, how much do the provinces get, what are the activities they're supposed to do. So in a sense, it's complete execution of a business plan, of a strategy. And this is something you again see much later, or maybe a couple of years later, when Gandhi is focusing on his constructive work of khadi, handspun, Harijan, and education. You see him again relying on this business community to roll out his khadi, the plan for khadi. Now, it's again for the business community, it's very, very simple. Here's a new product. This has to be made popular. This has to be rolled out to every district in India, so that the dominance or the dependence on foreign cloth is completely, is disturbed completely. And again, like I said, it is people like the business leaders, Jamnalal Bajaj and a few others, who come into this and execute that. So again, the Khadi board is created. They have 3 specific tasks. And if there's anybody from the corporate world over here, will understand this particular plan and the strategy. The first department set up is to make sure that there is, technically, the product is sound, which means the charkha is sound and everybody can use the charkha. Then you have a quality department that makes sure that the product, that the cloth or the yarn coming out is usable by various sections. And then you also, of course, have the marketing plan, where the plan was to reach out to every district in rural, in India. So again, this is not something that could have been done by regular people. He needed the capitalist class, he needed their money, he needed their expertise in a rollout. And that's what he does. And these are the broad ways in which the capitalist class or the industrialists kind of respond to Gandhi and support him. But if you look at what the movement does to this category of people, there are also these interesting tidbits that come out, and they range across, say, a Firoz Shah Sidhwa, who sets up a tiling company in 1921 and names it Bharat Flooring Tiles. He's obviously doing it because the movement has hit home. It is today, in 1920, a mass movement, not something that is concentrated within the lawyers and the political thinkers and the intellectuals. It's a movement that you and I can participate in. So Bharat Flooring Tiles comes into existence. You have Valchand Hirachand getting into shipping. He's going into coastal shipping, peninsula shipping, but then suddenly he realizes that he's not allowed to do his business, because that's what the laws of the land back then say, that Indian ships will not ply on the high seas. Indian ships will be restricted only to the coast. And that's restrictive. And he takes this up. And anyway, the environment back then is ready for him to launch this discriminatory angle to his battle of why he should be allowed to sail the high seas. So again, the entire Sindhya team shipping for, I think, the first 20 years was on very, very dubious ground because it was not allowed to do its business the way it, the way, say, a P&O was allowed to do or whatever. And he takes advantage of Valchand Hiracha and Narottam Morarji. They take advantage of the movement and pitch. And their pitch is, of course, it's a Swadeshi venture. A lot of businesses back then are taking advantage of it and pitching everything as a Swadeshi venture. So you have the Godrejes pitching their soap as a Swadeshi soap, an all-Indian 100% vegetarian soap. Again, tugging at the nationalistic sentiments of people. You also have some other cases where, say for instance, the Siplas, Khwaja Hamid of Sipla. Sipla actually has a wonderful archive, and so does Godrej, and you can see some of these things, again, because I'm an archivist, I will plug an archive over here. You have their history sort of showcased very well in these archives. But the Sipla story is also very, very interesting. Now, in the 1920s, Khwaja Hamid is not in Bombay. His nationalistic aspirations are being showcased back in Aligarh, where he's from. Then he goes to Germany to pursue higher studies, comes back, sets up Sipla sometime in the middle 1930s. And then you have, so again, while Sipla is not doing anything overtly for the movement, Sipla the brand, Sipla the company, is not doing anything overtly for the movement, there's Khwaja Hamid, who is contesting the Bombay Legislative Council elections in 1936. And right up to 1952, he holds that seat. And even when partition and the two-nation theory comes calling, and he is asked by the Muslim League to come to Pakistan, he refuses because his allegiance is with Bombay. His allegiance is with the country, unlike one or two other businessmen who do move to Pakistan. So in a way, I mean, whether it is pre-1920, whether it is, even post that in the 1920s or 30s or 40s, throughout this period, you do see business industrialists coming or intervening in one way or the other with the freedom movement. They're doing this, just to sum up, they're doing this in their individual capacity. It's not a stand that the company is taking. It's the stakes are too high for a company or a brand, to take. But there's also this interesting story, and I think Naresh will come to it later, as to what happens when, I give you one instance of Khwaja Hamid and partition, but what really happens, how does partition affect these companies, in 1947?
Thank you, Sanghamitra. Himanshu, you're supposed to tell us about architecture, and as you were pointing out, there was no direct influence that architecture played on the freedom movement, but as the freedom movement became more popular, this sort of ran parallel to a style that expressed the sort of aspirations of the age. Tell us about Bombay Deco.
So I'll step back a bit before I get into Bombay Deco. I think it's useful and important to understand that architecture, as we see it in history, is, you could say, perhaps the most conservative of the arts. And that's not surprising because it takes a lot of concentration of power and capital for significant buildings, public buildings, to be built. And it's also useful to see architecture in the context of a broader drive that every regime practices of creating its own space. So the British, they
through their, for instance, the railway network, they create
a particular national space which is an instrument of both economic exploitation but also of political control. So if we start seeing that intervention in space is very, very strongly, or space is a very important instrument of control and a condition of actually of real control, you begin to appreciate the difficulty and the lag in overt, say you might say, rebellion through architecture, because who's going to do it? You know, as Sanghamitra said, you know, it's there's a lot at stake for corporations or institutions to really go against. Having said this, what you do see is two kinds of things. One is that particular kinds of spaces that emerge, or say, as Amrit was pointing out to me earlier, say the chawl, you know, it emerges as a space, or the working class neighborhood emerges as a space which incubates a very vibrant and widespread kind of culture of resistance. So that's on the one hand. And these, we must remember, are this culture of resistance, whether it's at the in the minds of the industrialists and the business leaders or of the working class, they would have their own internal, they would have contradictions among themselves, but also they are in that sense lived. They emerge out of your experience, your aspirations. So they are difficult to map. They don't follow a simple kind of, say, classification of, you know, really rebellious, anti-colonial struggle only, many different sources. And so if we think of space and spatial production at multiple scales, one is at the formal, official, you know, big state, big capital kind of production of architecture and space, and of something intermediate perhaps, and something at the absolute grassroots against many odds. Now, in this this intermediate level, you might say, is the level of everyday aspiration, which is again formed out of diverse influences. And what we see taking hold in Mumbai very clearly in the early 20th century is a particular culture of consumption, which is tied to becoming, you know, especially for the elite, becoming modern. You know, whether it is eating out, going to restaurants, which is a very significant move because you are crossing boundaries of pollution, etc., in just going out and eating, right, in a restaurant. So on multiple fronts, these not revolutionary or not anti-colonial desires and practices are emerging. And I would like to think that we can think of Mumbai's, famous contribution, I'm not sure about great or whatever, in terms of, say, being a good starting, a good incubation space for Art Deco first, and we really have some fine buildings. And then, interestingly, the very soon, the hybridization of that into a kind of Indo-Deco. And both are interesting because with Art Deco, what you are seeing is not the resistance to colonial architecture or the architectural imagination took multiple forms. One was a revivalism, which didn't really sustain very strongly as high architecture, but which continues to date very, very strongly at the level of popular architecture, the way we imagine buildings and what we desire, etc. There was also the Gandhi model, which was whether Sabarmati or even more the brilliant Sevagram, which is, I think, one of the greatest almost is a revolutionary space, except it doesn't wear it on the shirt sleeve or on the roofs, right? So, and you had this, which is a very self-indulgent, very privileged kind of statement of aspiration, but what is significant about Art Deco is the move. When I go back and imagine, if I'm somebody who wants to build say Eros theater. You know, I am in a particular situation of dominance. The world is organized in a way that my world is dominated in every way, politically, economically, culturally, by the British model in some sense. And at this point, because of course, other things that are happening at a larger geopolitical scale, I have access to an American, more American kind of inspiration in the form of Art Deco. And one could say that this is one step away out of the umbrella that is forced upon you, and in that sense, a minor kind of assertion of independence. And this is interesting because it's, of course, not clearly revolutionary, or, you know, we're not talking of India, Bharat Mata, any of that, right? But this is also this in keeping with the way Mumbai has been built. There's a very interesting argument that historian Preeti Chopra makes, which is to say that Mumbai is really a joint enterprise, right? It's a joint enterprise between the British and the Mumbai business elite and community leaders, because we know for a fact that the business leadership in Mumbai was not dominated in that sense by the British, because they were really strong competitors. And they used that position. In fact, Preeti opens the book with an image of a fountain that was endowed by Kawasji Jahangir Redimani in Regent Park in London. Right? So it's a very interesting way in which you are tied into a kind of complicity as well as contradiction with your colonial masters, and in different ways. So that is the way one sees this coming in. And then it begins to make sense to see, for instance, Lakshmi building, right, with Lakshmi statue on top. And these are the ways in which you nibble away and this is interesting because it's, for me, for my taste, it's perhaps not fantastic enough, yeah, but as somebody who looks at history with some distance, I notice it, that you're actually preserving the syntax of a classical colonial Victorian syntax of architecture, how things are put together, but you are replacing the semantic crust with your motifs. And okay, that's something. What is significant, I think, is that this provided this kind of space. Remember also that architects are a very, very new and a very small community. And at that time, there was nothing. JJ had just started its course probably in 1998 or something like that. 1896, they had something very small. And the education was really to produce these craftsmen, technicians who would support the visions of British architects. Till 1920, you didn't really have independent Indian architects practicing. It was all these people brought in from Britain. So that is the context in which all of this emerges. So it takes some time, and through these steps, I think we are ready by the 1930s, which is not a long time. We've not had a long kind of transition, but 1930s and 40s, you have Bedwar building Dadar TT, okay, and slowly we move into a very assured kind of bridge into modernism, which would come later much more strongly in the work of Matre, for instance. So I think this is the way one can trace a particular practice of, you know, independence in terms of aspiration, and then capturing it in architecture in a very small way, but without necessarily, without being able to or even aspiring to shake up the overall spatial structure that has been already determined for you. And I'm not sure we've really done that properly even after independence.
Thanks. I'm just reminded of a ridiculous pun that Punch made when the Kawasji Jahangir fountain was opened almost opposite Albert Hall, and they said, "Parsi money is better than parsimony." So it clearly drew attention everywhere. We're sort of hopping all over the place, and so let's continue this journey. Murali, you have you were pointing out that too much of history of the freedom movement
is concentrated in South Mumbai, but it sort of, Sanghamitra spoke about Ghatkopar, and you have a special interest in the place you grew up in Mulund. Tell us what happened in Mulund.
It's not just me who grew up in Mulund. We have Amrit Ganga on the panel. I mean, and I think both of us are interested in that place. And I mean, as many of you might know that, I mean, Mumbai kept on growing slowly and surely. It grew, contracted. I mean, they kept on adding new places from the 1920s. The Bombay Suburban District was formed, and some villages were added. Some of the villages of what is the Salset Island or the Shashti Island were added. And it was only, and it expanded in the 40s, and it was only in 57 that Mulund, which was part of the Thana district, was Mulund and the band all the way going up to Borivali and Uttan, was added to the Bombay municipal limits. But they were already suburbs of Bombay. I mean, the day the local train started in 1853, the historic city of Thana became a suburb of Bombay. I mean, and from then on, it was just decline into suburbia. But even as late as 1900, each of these villages, as Amrit rightly pointed out, they were all villages, and each of these villages could aspire to still be a town. And Mulund especially was one of the few places in Bombay which was planned. Mulund West, is if any of you care to come down there, you will see a grid pattern, and it's a very large space which is laid out very well with broad roads. All of that was done in the early 1920s. The plan must have been earlier, and it was laid out, and it was so well laid out that even now it's still a quite a salubrious place to stay as compared to the rest of the city. And it was again 1920s when Gandhi came in. The impact was there all across the nation. Earlier it was, the Congress movement was really an elite movement. And so you had Congress committees being formed everywhere. And very soon you had the Mulund Congress Committee. Mulund, the local area Congress Committee, was formed in, I think, 1923. And that was just after the non-cooperation movement, and there was a brief lull. So that lull was used to sort of, you know, regenerate the nation through khadi, through education, through a few other things. And the president of the Mulund Congress Committee was a gentleman called Virji Gangajar Maheshwar or Maheshwari. That is the contraction which is used now. And he was a Jain Dasa Oswal. Gujarati man who was also a businessman, and who took on the mantle of both the Mulund Residents Association, which sort of negotiated the building of the Mulund station with the railways and for halts on the local train in Mulund, and which also sort of started working for establishing hospitals and so on and so forth. So when the freedom movement sort of flared up after Gandhi came into the picture, the Congress Committee was formed. Khadi was sort of adopted, as Sanghamitra just pointed out, perhaps part of that marketing plan. And very soon you had schools being built. And Mulund became one of the many, many places where you had picketing of toddy shops, Naresh. And you had the Congress Committee pretty active there. And just to sort of, you know, speak to Amrit's Mahila Mumbai, and one of the leaders of this movement was a Mahila, and you had this lady called, she was the wife of this gentleman Virji Gangajar, and her name was Ratnabai, and she for various reasons took on the mantle of leadership, establishing various organizations working towards a similar goal. She was part of the Congress Committee. She was on the managing committee of the Mulund Residents Association. And she herself set up a few institutions. I mean, one was educating the ladies. So you had the Sri Vanita Jnana Mandir formed in Mulund in the mid-1920s. And the first real school in Mulund also, which was named after her when she was alive, because she was the first person to step forward and make a very generous donation. So you still have in Mulund the Sri Ratnabai Virji Girls and Boys Marathi and Gujarati School, which still functions. And if you sort of care to wander inside, you'll see a very beautiful portrait of a very beautiful lady. This lady Ratnabai was very beautiful, and she was the person who sort of
galvanized the movement after all the people who were in the part of the leadership were arrested after the civil disobedience movement. So you had her husband and practically the entire committee in the Thana jail. And she was a person who then took on the mantle of leadership and became the president. So you had, I mean, as Amrit rightly pointed out, you had Mahilas in Mumbai who were leading. And this lady, she died of a certain illness in 1932. And in 1933, you have a real huge omnibus memorial volume for her, in which all kinds of leaders are writing about Mulunni Veer Mahila Ratnabai. And we have memoirs from all kinds of people, including Savarkar. For example, Savarkar was a jailmate of her husband and came to see all of them. And he writes a very long note about her life and her contributions. You have Balasaheb K talking about her. So you have these kind of forgotten leaders who were leading the movement in suburban Bombay in their own little way and establishing institutions which are still functioning.
I suppose you were right to shoot me that look about toddy. My Bhandari ancestors, of course, made their living tapping toddy. But when Gandhi introduced prohibition, many delegations went to him to beg him to stop. And there were Parsi liquor traders, and the Archbishop of Bombay was among them. And Gandhi was, of course, impervious to these pleas. Amrit, you also have some suburban stories to tell.
I begin with Mulund. I spent my childhood in Mulund, and the first film that I saw, I remember my father had taken to Jawahar talkies. I think Mulund is the only, still it is there. That's the only suburb that perhaps in whole of India, which is named after Jawahar. There is in Malad Kasturba talkies. That's perhaps the only one named after Kasturba. And this year is not only Gandhi 150, it's also Bab 150. We don't remember her. It's always Gandhi 150. It's also Kasturba's 150. Kasturba was 6 months older than Gandhi. And this is 158. Both were born in 1869. So Kasturba talk is in Malad. Perhaps very unique. Only one, perhaps. I don't know whether any other cinema house is named after Kasturba in Mumbai or perhaps in India. I don't know. But this film I saw, first film in my life, was Jagruti, Satyen Bose. De di hame azadi bina khadag bina dal, sabarmati ke sant tune kar diya kamal. That Kavi Pradeep song. This film was shot in Filmistan in Goregaon. So we are shifting from Mulund to Goregaon. So Goregaon is important. If you see this film, you can also see parts of Goregaon because it's not completely in Filmistan. Filmistan is very important film studio in history of Mumbai. Also, history of independence of Mumbai. Both Filmistan is offshoot of Bombay talkies because they separated and then they established Filmistan. This film was shown shot there, Jagruti, and this is Gandhi. This is the independence movement. So there are many Achyut Kanya, Bombay talkies. It's directly influenced by Gandhi. Before that, Ranjit Film Company had made a film called Achyut. That was early 30s, also Gandhi influence. So Gandhi, you cannot disconnect Gandhi from independence movement and Mumbai. But what is important, I very firmly believe, is Mahila Mumbai. The Mahila Mumbai has to, the women, the iconic photograph that you have, I have used the same in my article about Gandhiji and Mumbai ni Mahilao, 1918 to 1934. And these are only women who have actually supported Gandhi. And so firmly, so confirmed way, not males, it's only women who supported him. And therefore he always believed in, and they collected so much money, the women had collected so much money for, I will give you some examples of this, where the women had invited Gandhi and he addressed meetings of women. It was first in 20th February 1918, These are iconic locations in Mumbai. We have to really locate them and write about them. Vanita Vishram, for example, near Arkisandas Hospital, Pratna Sabha, is important location for connecting Mumbai with independence. So on 20th February 1918, Mumbai Pratna Sabha area, Bhagini Samaj is still there, and Gandhiji had gone there to address a meeting,
and he was the chairperson of that meeting, and the subject was women's education. He was speaking on women's education. And then another meeting was held in Morarji Gokulda Sabhagra, and that was also important meeting for women. All these meetings were organized by women independently. Here I also remember when Murali was talking about, you know, papad that we eat every day. What papad? Lijjat papad. Five women came together, middle class women. They said, let's do something. And they started this Lijjat papad cooperative. It's world renowned now. It's started by five middle class women of Mumbai. And they were highly influenced by Gandhi and the nationalist movement, whatever you call it. But this was done right here. The papad is Mumbai's, not only pav bhaji or whatever, but papad. Papad is done by women, and that's important. Papad is important icon of the city. So this, then China Bagh. You know where is China Bagh? Young people should know. Where is China Bagh? Near Sipitang, Cherni Road. Yeah. So this China Bagh, 6th April 1919, Gandhiji went to address a meeting. They invited Gandhi. He went beheaded and barefoot. He goes there, and there was a huge meeting of women at Chowpatty. He addresses that meeting. Then he also meets police commissioner, because the Gandhian literature, independence, the nationalist literature was being sold at Chowpatty, and that was not allowed by the British police. Policemen were Indian, but they were working for Britishers. But these women had protested against that. There was a meeting at French Bridge against that law by women. 1919, again, on 11th of April 1919, Bapu was in jail, and then he was released. Then Umar Sobhani, there was Anasuya Sarabhai along with him. And they both were together with Gandhi. There were a lot of problems, many disturbances happening around. Gandhi was everywhere. And these Umar Sobhani and Anasuya Sarabhai were supporting it. Crawford Market, there was a kind of rebel. And then Gandhi had gone there. Then it's important meeting happens in Vanita Vishram. And the chairperson was Sarojini Naidu. Then at Paidhuni, Jain Mahila Samaj had invited Gandhi to address them. Everywhere Gandhi went, but all these meetings were organized not by males but women of Mumbai. And therefore, Mahila Mumbai becomes very important. We always talk about money about Mumbai, financial capital of city of India, or Bollywood becomes the capital of India, Indian film industry. But there's something else. These narratives are important. How women have contributed to India's independence movement, and therefore Mumbai becomes important to me.
Thanks, Amrit. Sanghamitra, what price did these industrialists have to pay for their support in the nationalist movement, and what could they teach some of our industrialists today?
No, thank you. So there's also this little bit that happens in Villeparle. You have the Villeparle Satyagraha camp. It's around Dandi, I want to say. I think so. But anyway, Gandhi can't come to Bombay, and so there are people who set up the camp, in Villeparle. There's a Satyagraha camp. I get the connection. Gandhi used to live in Juhu. Perhaps there's a lot that's happening there. And from there, there are, of course, all kinds of volunteers and leaders over there who are sort of, I think, protesting the Salt Act. Right, so which is why it's next to the seashore. So that's also there. And something, I may be entirely wrong, but again, there's a woman angle to it also, because if I'm not wrong, there's this, everybody knows of Janki Kutir in Juhu, which is today a Prithvi Theatre. So Janki Kutir is actually named after Janki Devi Bajaj, who is Jamnalal's wife.
And, you know, so she also is participating. She's one of those people who is hosting these satyagrahis there, cooking for them and supporting them. And, of course, moving. There's that entire angle about how women come out and encourage other women to further step out. So that's, again, the role that Janki Devi plays. But, yes, going back to your question, the price they paid, I think they were throughout very, very smart. All right, they knew what was at stake. They knew how far they could go, as long as the repercussion was on them, the individual, the person, it was fine. But somehow they always made sure that the business wasn't impacted as much. Now you have somebody again like Jamnalal, for instance. He is given the title of Rai Bahadur in 1917. He's obviously given that title because at that stage the imperialist forces could see that he was getting too close to Gandhi, and somehow they thought that by giving him this title they would be able to sort of pull him away from Gandhi's influence. But that doesn't happen. Jamnalal continues getting influence, and at some point of time he regards Gandhi as his adopted father, and all of that is happening. But as soon as, you know, as it's 1920s, 22, 23, suddenly he realizes that this is not the recognition that he is craving. And he gives up the title. Now, that's a bold step. Again, you have a lot of these industrialists still then becoming justices of peace of Bombay city. And then suddenly, post the movement becoming a mass movement, they aren't taking this up. Now, one may argue that it didn't make for great optics, and therefore the industrialists or the mill owners shied away from it. But all said and done, what I'm trying to say here is at the end of the day, they made sure that they were still running profitable businesses. And any extra money was then plowed into this movement. That's the way they function. But things change, like I mentioned earlier, when partition comes knocking. Now, the industrialist class responds to partition in very different ways. And that's when they start paying the price for it, especially the big corporations start paying the price for it. Now, there's somebody like J.D. Birla, who we all know, his closeness to Gandhi, how he helps Birla House everywhere. All major cities have a Birla House. Gandhi's lived in all of these places. We know that connection. But now, G.D. Birla was very practical about his outlook to partition, about the two-nation theory. It was very simple. His response was that if you have a business partner and if he were unhappy and he wanted to strike out, would you forcibly keep him? Would you forcibly tie him down? You wouldn't. So if someone is unhappy and if someone wants their fair share, you let them go and you figure it out. That was G.D. Birla. But not everyone responded like this. You have Lala Shri Ram in North India, in Delhi, in Punjab, for whom partition of Punjab, the two-nation theory, was sacrilege. He did not believe that would ever happen. He did not believe that India, a divided India would ever survive. Yes, the business community, manufacturing, mill owners, was apprehensive about the loss of territory, marketing territory, the loss of raw materials. We do know of these things about the fact that the jute mills were on one side of the border, but the raw material was coming from the other side of the border. All of these things were concerns, and that's when it really hits them hard. Again, very economic reasons, but that's when they start taking actual measures. Now, and there's this beautiful story of a large corporation trying to get ready or trying to prepare itself for partition. You have the Lever Brothers. The Lever Brothers marketing and sales department that's based out of Bombay is headed by this gentleman called P.K. Tandon, and he's written this fantastic book, an omnibus called The Punjab Trilogy or Punjab Century or some such thing. And there he points out how when partition was about to happen, it was, he had, there were these, his Dalda distributors, his Dalda dealers, there was something he had to do, something that Lever Brothers had to do about this group. There were a whole lot of these Dalda dealers who were based out of what became Pakistan. They wanted to come to India, and it was Unilever that stepped out, and P.K. Tandon and the marketing and sales that stepped out and reached out to these people. He managed to transmit messages to his Dalda distributors on that side of the border, saying that you somehow come to India, we will figure it out for you. We'll give you new territories, we'll give you a starting capital, and we will figure that out for you. Unfortunately, there's not too much study that's been done about how various other companies were responding to partition. We do know that, like I mentioned, the Bharat Tiles some time back. Now, the Bharat Tiling Company was started by four partners. Two of them were from Karachi. We do know of these instances. We also have the Mukan Steel that starts off in Lahore, but then has a few, you know, around the 1940s, early 1940s, sets up steel plants in India as well. Now, that becomes, again, everybody knows of, I mean, there's that beautiful picture of books being divided into India's property and Pakistan's property. But then these businessmen had their actual assets and properties to divide, employees to take care of, channel partners to worry about, create a new network. And I think that's what really hits them. Till then, till the freedom struggle is really happening, it's emotional. It's, I believe in this cause, so I will give you the money. But their organizational powers as companies comes to light, you know, closer to 1946, 1947.
Thanks. I'm glad you mentioned Tandon, whose Punjab trilogy actually contains some fascinating vignettes of life in Bombay, and he moved to Bandra. And so it's quite interesting to see his portraits of the suburb growing in the 1960s. Himanshu, Indian architecture actually really comes into its own in the post-independence period when it begins to sort of embody the aspirations of this new nation. Tell us something about that.
So you can see, it's a very interesting thing to note that though Mumbai was a major kind of ground of the mobilization and strengthening of the freedom movement, particularly in architecture, after independence, Mumbai never really took on a concerted role the way Ahmedabad did. And that's a very interesting story because Mumbai and Ahmedabad were part of the same presidency, and there was, of course, rivalry. So Ahmedabad managed to actually create a kind of, you know, as a partnership of various business leaders and effectively wrest away important institutions and create and, you know, invite new institutions. So IIM, for instance, was supposed to come to Mumbai, and the Sarabhais, Vikram, etc., Vikram and Kasturbai, I think, they managed to have it taken to Ahmedabad. And similarly, they did that with modern architecture, getting Corbusier down to design important buildings in Ahmedabad, setting up NID, setting up SEPT through Doshi, etc. So Mumbai, it's very interesting. Mumbai actually is the place where the architecture profession as a profession takes stronghold from the 20s onwards. But after independence, you know, we've kind of no more. As a city, we are not really anywhere except for individual practices, greatest among those being, of course, Charles Correia. But Correia is, so Correia's work is very interesting because, of course, apart from its own architectural merits, he's, on the one hand, he's very engaged with Mumbai, but more at the level of a city planner or visionary in that sense. And in his buildings, he's actually addressing a much bigger global kind of audience. So there is, of course, Correia's work, but also many others like, you know, Kamo Iyer. They created a kind of, say, you might say, a culture of building, but Mumbai never really made it something significant. In fact, post-independence architecture, there isn't a lot. Maybe in the last 20 years, we are seeing at least a kind of what I call a kind of democratization of good modernist taste, if you might want to call that, right? And that is, in a sense, we have learned how to turn a corner better, for instance. So, but we have, of course, seen new, the city just with its own kind of dynamic of expanding and simply the pressures of urbanization, we have seen a completely new city take charge. And now, since you mentioned suburbs, we know that within a few decades, you know, it was really the suburbs that were booming in terms of population. And today we are, of course, the island city is losing population. The CBD is moving north, many CBDs now than one. So I think it's a very interesting phase. We've not really got a handle on it. But also useful to mention, there were some strands which are very precious, which were the kind of antithesis to modernism that Korea and, say, Kamu Ayer represented, even if it was indigenized, was the more romantic tradition, which we have very few examples. One is TISS, which was built by Durga Bajpai. Very different inspiration, very much a romantic architecture, connection between human being and nature and natural materials, all of that. And then, of course, Nari Gandhi, you know, who's again an kind of an extreme version of the genius artist, you know, practicing in architecture completely outside all professional norms, you know, borrowing 20 bucks to have lunch somewhere from the client, you know, that kind of model entirely. But doing fantastic work. So, but we have, that strand has not gone very far in general in India, but that's a different story.
Thanks. I think we're almost out of time. So we'll take a couple of questions. Put your hands up. Please ask questions and don't make comments. And if you make comments, we will snatch the mic away from you in rude fashion. Oh, there's no mic. Yell.
And tell us who you're addressing the question to.
To you.
I'm the moderator.
No, the reason why I'm addressing it to you, my name is, so since we're talking about a freedom fighter that got blown out of cannons, what the hell. My name is Sarita Fernandes. I am the chief conservation officer for an organization called Vana Shakti, which is an environment education organization fighting the coastal road case and the RA metro project case. And through my organization and going through it, I have come to hate this city. And while I, you know, sit in courts and sit in the Supreme Court and the Bombay High Court, I came across your book, City Adrift, which is a biography on Bombay. And it made me realize which history we have, and that's the reason why I'm attending this talk today. I would just like your perspective on, I don't know whether you know the current environmental issue that city is facing, with the different aggressive capitalist projects that we have and the type of protests that come from citizen-driven movements itself.
Can you cut to the question, please?
Yeah, so what is your take on the future of Bombay when it comes to environmentalism and Bombay's history with freedom movements?
Yo. Okay. Yeah, it's a big thing. So, you know, Bombay has been dying for 120 years. The first professor of sociology appointed to the Bombay University, Patrick Geddes, held a sort of exhibition in about 1900 or 1901 on how to save Bombay. I have on my shelf a series of pamphlets in almost 10-year series, becoming much more frequent by the time we get to the 80s, of how to save Bombay. And yet we've survived. At this moment, I must confess that I despair too. Starting perhaps with the mill land case, where it was clear that we had a crisis on our hands and we had a solution, perhaps, and capital just swept us away. Every time we've been thrown a lifeline, we obdurately reject it. I think that is now seen in the debate about the Eastern Waterfront, which was supposed to be opened up to the public. And of course now, sort of political interests want to make sure we have a marina and we want to have luxury housing. And in the coastal road. And I one of the reasons I keep going back to the freedom struggle is because there was a time when this city, when people across classes were able to come together to see a common interest. Some of this, I think, just has to do with public space. We all shared the same public spaces. We all rode the same train. And I think this forged a public consciousness, which now in the age of the gated community, in the age of the automobile, we have completely lost. We don't even visually now see people who are not of our class. The flyovers mean that we jump over areas like Muhammad Ali Road or other places. And I think we need to reclaim public space. To me, it's fascinating to see the contrast with Delhi, which is in the process, I think, of manufacturing a public. Delhiites of all classes are now getting into the metro. Yes, it's very expensive, and that leaves out the very poor. But Delhiites are reclaiming public space. They're reclaiming public transport. And I think that's what Bombay needs to see. And to rediscover the spirit of the independence movement, where we saw that we all need to hang together, or we hang individually, as they say. Sir,
my question to Sanghamitra. You mentioned about a lot of business families contributing to the fund, which Gandhi was trying to attain. What were the take of families who were not really as supportive in, saying that, we're very happy in the kind of position that we're in with the Brits being there? Say the likes of the generations of the GG boys or the Ready Moneys who had been thriving since then. What were the kind of turmoil or situation that they were facing at the time of, very close to independence then?
So, not much work that's done on that aspect of these families. Now, of what, what their response was. But it turns out that the feeling that you get is that much like today, there are multiple Bombays in one time. Even today, you don't have everyone aligning to a particular political vision, right? There is that, there's that multiplicity of perspective and things like that. So I think that's happening there as well. In the 1920s, the entire Congress movement just seems a little strange and far-fetched. You also have the Congress infighting happening, where part of the Congress Working Committee wants to use constitutional methods, while some others want to use Gandhi Satyagraha methods. Again, a very, very, a very, very novel concept. So there is, the leading political party in the country is making a mockery of itself by this infighting that's happening. So it's very easy for a section of the society not to align with this and stay away and still be unaffected entirely. Again, with this category, it's only, say, I think, post the middle 1930s, early 1940s, when you know independence and freedom is inevitable, that you actually see a sudden change. Now again, World War II means it's a great time for the industrialist community. There's an increase in manufacturing, there's just general, everything is very, very bullish. And post that, you do know, suddenly I think there's that confidence that comes in, that yes, an independent India will work, because now you have the economic might and the power to sustain on your, on your own, and you do not need, someone from England to tell you what is right and what is not. So I think that's where you see a change. But to kind of understand their psyche, there's not much work that's been done, and again, that's an area that perhaps still needs to be looked into. Perhaps research needs to be done.
Can I just add my two bits, whatever little work I have done? About a year back, I edited a book of articles by J.R.B. G.G. Boy, who was exactly one of these people, who was old money. And his grandfather, Byram G.G. Boy, was in Bombay the Mukesh Ambani of the 19th century. They practically owned textile mills. Every industry, they had something going. And this man, Gigi Boy, got an education, went abroad, came back, joined the Congress in 1915. He was a protege of Feroz Shah Mehta. He was vigorously campaigning for some kind of autonomy. And then 1920, Gandhi has taken over the Congress. And he calls for the non-cooperation movement. And so that is something which they just cannot stomach. And you have our friend J.R.B. Gigi Boy writing and publishing a pamphlet called The Anti-Non-Cooperation Movement in Bombay, which is not there in that book because it was not about Bombay history. But they really are shocked by Gandhi. The old money is shocked by Gandhi. And this man was politically active, and he really wrote out a pamphlet listing out the causes why we should boycott Gandhi. And what happened was he had to leave the Congress. He and a whole raft of people left the Congress, joined the sort of central socialist party. They formed a new party, and that finally sort of got elbowed out of our history by the 1940s.
Thanks so much. It's time to wrap up. Go ahead.
Thank you to our wonderful panel. This was a very insightful conversation. I think we need more time, but as our hashtag says, learning never stops. Thank you, audience, for being here. Happy Independence Day. These won't be as successful if you weren't here. The next one in the series is on the 25th of September, and it's on sports and the city. Again, thank you very much for being here, and have a good night. Happy Independence Day.